Welcome to this episode of Front Runner 2020. I'm Ron Turner. Before we start the program, let me say a few words about our purpose. We launched the Front Runner 2020 series to support and encourage you on your journey towards elected office. We present relevant programming for those aspiring to run so you can lay the groundwork and be prepared. In addition, some of our presentations are focused on strategies and tactics for use during your campaign. Our guests are the best in their field, and in some specialties, this means going outside of politics to the business community. You'll see that we emphasize marketing and building your brand as a core strategic component. There are many things you can do before you announce your candidacy that will enhance your potential and eliminate roadblocks that may get in your way. We recognize this path as a matter of personal growth and, yes, a calling. Please tell us what you need to be more successful, and we'll plan future programs around your feedback. John Hoadley is known for a long line of accomplishments as an organizer and a leader. On a national level, he served as executive director of National Stonewall Democrats. His work has ranged from the national stage to include statewide initiatives as well as local grassroots organizing. He has consistently achieved breakthrough results in nurturing membership, inspiring volunteers, and recruiting donors. This is what you must do to advance your political career. Especially before you run for office, you should be building your network and laying the foundation for your future campaign organization. Everyone you know is a potential volunteer and donor. Your strongest supporters and believers will both work for your campaign and donate money to it. Learn from John how to apply the know-how he has gained from his experience to your own development as an activist, community leader, and political candidate. John?
Thanks, Ron. I appreciate that introduction, and I'm excited about being here tonight. You know, we're going to be talking a little bit more about what it means, as to like that magic that just happened there, about what it means to have your view yourself as an organization and how that's going to be helpful in the work that you're doing as you're preparing to run for office or run your campaign. You know, I think Ron summarized it pretty well. You know, this is about setting yourself up and setting up the people that interact with you on a regular basis to have a really positive user experience with you individually, with the stories you're telling, with the events you're hosting or attending, so that they know that there's value in you and the work you're doing, and they want to invest as you develop as a leader and a candidate. So, you know, what does this really mean? First, you know, it's about you as an organization is really just a fancy way of saying we're going to do some strategic planning using an organizational model for you. And then, you know, thinking more concretely about how do we translate that work directly into relevant pieces for your campaign. You know, I'll start by saying from the big crux of what we're doing tonight is going to focus more on people than it is going to focus on money. But as Ron noted in the beginning, those two things are really tied, and they go hand in hand. So let's give people a great experience about you, and they're going to feel great about giving to you as well. So let's tackle the first question. Why are you an organization? Well, it's simple. Organizations have multiple intersecting departments that, when working, I suppose I should say, well together, create a fully functional unit. So there's different parts of you that show up in the world in different ways, and we need to make sure that we are thinking about some of those core components and getting them all on the same page so that you are presenting an authentic, functional you. And the second thing I'd add is that organization and brand go together. Now, there's probably a little distinction here, right? A brand is associated with an organization, just like a brand is associated with you. But the brand hangs on something, and so we've got to build the structure that brand is going to hang on. So remember from the first episode where we talked about the USA, right? Unify, simplify, and amplify as three core lessons when you're thinking about your brand. So, you know, how do we bring things together, say it quickly, and then get it out in the world? We're not going to spend a whole lot more time tonight talking about those pieces. I invite you to go back and listen to episode one where Josh talks about that. And, you know, I'd also invite you to think about some of the other core components of brand, because it is important when thinking about yourself as an organization. So take a moment to think a little bit more about your passions and your interests, the skills that you bring to the table, your contribution style, meaning, you know, when you're in a group or in a work situation, what are you bringing forward and putting on the table for other people? Thinking about your arena, you know, a lot of times people say, are you a big fish in a little pond, a little fish in a big pond, or some combination of that? Thinking about the things that make you unique and individual, and of course then thinking about your goals, which we're going to actually talk more about later. But if you're keeping these thoughts together, you're going to be well in where you need to go for your brand. And that's important because the follow-up question, and something that I would ask you to think about after the presentation tonight, would be, who does your brand appeal to most? And the reason you're going to want to do that is because it provides a gut check as to whether or not the image that you're building out in the world is going to connect with the people that you want it to connect with. So for example, if I think that part of my brand is I want to be an ethical person and I want people to think he's really ethical, then I need to ask the question, and who's going to care about that? Because it informs sort of the client and customer base for who I'm going to be surrounding myself with to build a strong foundation moving forward. But that's enough about brand. Let's talk about organization. So what's in an organization? You know, there's a whole lot, and this is not going to be an exhaustive list, of things that fit an organization, but I want to focus on four departments. The first is management, so someone's got to run the show. The second is communications and marketing. Someone's got to be out there telling the story of what the organization's doing. The third is sales and development. So someone's got to be bringing in the revenue or making the case about why what you're doing is valuable. Otherwise, that business is not going to last long. And, of course, your human resources and membership. So really the core components of the people that make your organization work. And, you know, this isn't going to be rocket science, but it turns out that organization departments and you as an organization translate really well. So the first being the fact that management is going to be your plan. We're going to dive into all these in just a second, but you've got to have a plan to where you're going. The communications and marketing becomes your story, and so this is going to be how you tell your story to the world. The sales and development are your value. Not your values, necessarily the things you're standing for, but it's got to be, you've got to be able to pitch yourself in the activities you're doing and characterize it as your value. And then finally, your human resources and membership, these are going to be the relationships that you'll build on everything else with. So let's get the first three right, and then we'll come back and be able to do that the relationship piece well. You know, when you put all this together, you as an organization are going to boil down to two core components. You need people and money. And I think, you know, we've all probably seen this equation, and this is going to be my only hokey PowerPoint transition in the whole thing. But, you know, organized people plus organized money equals what? Political power. I mean, these are... If we set ourselves up to be successful in these two components, we'll be successful in politics. And, you know, organizations provide a structure to get both of these pieces. Because people and money don't just show up. They need a structure to come together. And that's what you as an organization are going to end up providing and needing. But like I said, let's kind of delve into the core components a little bit more. So management's your plan. You know, the first thing I'd note here is that you need some goals. And this isn't rocket science, like I said earlier, but you should figure out some combination of long-term goals and short-term goals. I think they should be simple and easy to recite, so I'd say something like three or less. And for me, and a piece of advice I'd share is make them quantifiable. So it's harder to fudge if you're getting closer. That way, then you can hold yourself accountable in a more realistic way. But just like any good management has a plan, includes a timeline. So I want you to actually start thinking about managing and planning your time. I know we all do this in some form or another, throughout our days. And a lot of times it's about, kind of thinking about, oh, here's where I'm going to be, or putting a couple things in a calendar. But what I really want you to do, challenge you to do, is write things down. Because as you're developing your leadership and you as an organization, you need to have a written set of documents that describe where you're going, and so other people can follow right along with you. This is going to really help as you're thinking about campaigns later on, so you might as well get in the good habit and as you're moving in this part of the phase. So,
you know, John, that's really good advice, because I know that's what is always taught about managing a campaign and in personal development and time management, that is, put it in writing.
Exactly. So that's what one of your homework pieces will be. You know, write some short-term goals on a piece of paper and post them where you'll see them. I mean, this sounds kind of, you know, it's a little new agey in that sense that, does that really make a difference? The short answer is yes. I don't know about you, Ron, but I've never walked into a real campaign office where I don't see big notes on the wall, because, people know if you write them down and you look at them, you're going to be more likely to follow through on them.
Well, exactly right. It's partly to keep yourself focused and remind you, but especially when you're working with others, that's a good point.
So let's talk about communications and marketing. So this is going to be your story. You're going to do the work to figure out how to unify, simplify, and amplify those words that describe you best. But I want you to think about a couple of pieces here in a broader context about your story. The first is, what makes you compelling? You know, and I think that this is more of an external thought. So, you know, how do other people view you, and how do you show up in the world that engages people and makes you stand out from the crowd? And, you know, the piece here is that this is going to be a reflection from how other people see you, as opposed to something about asking yourself as part of your story, what do you stand for, which might be an internal set of values. The interesting thing that happens is if there's a gap between how you show up in the world and what you want to be showing up as. And what we've seen time and time again from politicians is that when there is a significant gap between the things they stand for and the things they do, that's when they get in trouble. You know, the funny thing is that there are politicians that, you know, we love to hate, but they let it all hang out in the world, and we know that. And so voters, the public, their colleagues know exactly what they're getting with them. It's only the real scandal only happens when people aren't being honest about how they present to the world and what they're actually doing.